when I heard about this thing, I was, oddly enough, my family were not, we were out getting a Christmas tree on Sunday morning, and came back and saw the news and saw that these four officers were down. And I got to tell you, I thought about Brett Farrar, and I know the anguish that I went through losing one. I honestly just can't imagine what it would be like to lose four. You know, my thoughts are really with the families. That's why we're here. We're here to honor these families, let them know we're behind them. But I want you to know there are a lot of victims here. And they're not just family members. They are sisters and brothers and moms and dads. They've had a huge loss. Our police officers are also victims. And I can tell you right now, in the coming months and years, these surviving police officers are going to go through a hell of a hard time. Some of them may turn to alcohol. Some of them may get divorced. Almost all of them are going to suffer in their work performance. And they're going to try to keep that in, because that's what police officers do. And I guess I would make this offer right now. And I would say that if any of you officers out there are feeling like you just can't go on and you just can't get any help at all, you call me. My number is 360-961-0102. That's my cell phone number. I'm in no position to say that I can help you, but I can certainly do my best to make sure that you do get the right help. Because I think the one tragedy that would make this even worse than losing these six officers and having 13 kids without their parents is to lose more of you. My thoughts are really with you. I'm like Senator Delvin. I go down to that memorial periodically, and when I'm feeling pretty down, I can go down there and look at that memorial, and it kind of brings me back. You know, I'm like Senator Delvin. I'm a survivor of 27 years in law enforcement. I have a son that's a police officer, and I got to tell you, I think about this a lot. And so my thoughts are with you, and it truly is an honor to have you in our building today so that we can say thanks to you and give you our blessings. These are very, very tough times. Thank you.
We have Senator Roach.
Madam President, members of the Senate, and people of the state of Washington, and those that we are here to honor today, I wanted to rise and let you know how much I feel for you and your families, and tell you that I can't keep but having the poet's line come to mind, that they also serve who only stand and wait, that every time your loved one leaves the door, you wait to see if he or she will come back. It's the same thing that's experienced by our military today. As we give honor to them, we give honor to you. There's always been something about someone in uniform. I attended the memorial for Mark Reniger and Tina Griswold and Ron Owens and Greg Richards, and sat right behind the governor, right behind the lieutenant governor and other statewide elected officials, and our National Guard, Timothy Loewenberg, our general of the National Guard, adjutant general. And we were very close to watching the ceremony, and it was a tough one. It was really tough. But incredibly awe-inspiring to see the brothers and sisters, not just from our state, but from around the country and from Canada. But we have something to do. We're not only, those of us that are seated are not just only those that are standing and waiting, because we all stand and wait when it comes to our community, and this is part of our community. In this legislative session, we're going to do everything we can to close some loopholes to reduce the chance that this kind of thing will happen again. On the Sentencing Guidelines Commission, where I sit, and Senator Klein, we're going to make sure that we make it harder when somebody comes from one state to another, for instance. we're going to be addressing what happens when there's a three striker up with a felony sitting there and somehow they manage to leave. We find that it wasn't the rules in the judicial system that, well, that was the problem. It was, it needed to be changed. We're going to be doing that. I think that there are many other things that we can do, and I want you to know that we're committed here on the floor of the Senate, and I know that the members of the State House of Representatives are also. It's the only thing we can do to try to make it better for the future, and we're committed to doing that. We love you and your families and stand and wait with you as our law enforcement and our military go out that door. We want them back. Thank you.
The question before the body is the final passage of Senate Resolution Number 8687. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposes, no. The resolution is adopted. I am pleased to recognize Detective Ed Troyer of the Pierce County Sheriff's Office to say a few words on behalf of the officers and their families. Detective Troyer.
On behalf of law enforcement throughout the state, it's my honor to be here today to represent the officers who recently lost their lives in the line of duty and to represent their families. What brought us here today started on Halloween night, October 31st, when Seattle Police Officer Timothy Britton was executed and Officer Britt Sweeney was shot by gunfire from another vehicle. A month later, on November 29th, Lakewood Police Officer Greg Richard, Officer Tina Griswold, Officer Ronald Owens, and Sergeant Mark Renninger were executed in a coffee shop while writing reports and preparing for patrol that day. A month after that, on December 28th, Pierce County Deputy Kent Mandel died from gunshot wounds he received days earlier in a domestic situation, and Sergeant Nick Hausner was shot at the same time and was recovering from a serious, almost fatal wound. That's eight police officers and deputies shot in a two-month period, with six of them being killed. The deaths of these officers have left four widows, a widower, along with 13 children who have lost a parent. The loss is felt deeply by the community. We see how bad it hurts them, and we in law enforcement have heavy hearts and miss them daily. We in law enforcement also know that there is no way to guarantee our safety. By the very nature of policing itself places us at risk. We know and accept that. In fact, we have taken an oath to do so, but there are ways to reduce risk. While our politicians do the work that voters have elected them to do, we need to avoid the illusion that laws enforce themselves. Often legislation is well motivated, but there are no resources to carry out the mandates. Let's not be the cop-killing capital of the USA here in the state of Washington. It is unacceptable. It hurts the hearts of our citizens, and it will hurt our economy. Businesses will think twice about expanding or relocating a business to an area with horrendous crime. In Pierce County, we were once known as the meth capital of the United States with over 350 meth labs in a one-year period. New laws were put into place, and this is very important. The resources to back the laws up were also put in place. In 1.5 years, we were able to cut meth by 90% in Pierce County, down to one of the lowest in the nation. This proves that with resources, we in law enforcement will take care of business and can get the job done. Currently, we are not supervising felons, contemplating closing jails, contemplating closing prisons, and law enforcement agencies are losing positions. My department alone has lost 15 positions, have been cut here in the latest round of budget issues. We're already one of the lowest staffed agencies in the state. This is a bad mix, and may be creating what can only be called the perfect storm. Having any legislation without funding for resources, pushing the mandates down to local agencies who are already understaffed throughout the state, the rest of the law enforcement agencies in here are all facing the same problem, will only provide shoddy of any enforcement behind the laws. So we in law enforcement are calling on you to make long-lasting positive change for our citizens, our law enforcement agencies, and to protect our future generations. Thank you.